Dr. Diana obtained her PhD degree in Natural Sciences Applied Geoinformatics from the Salzburg University. She is a lecturer in Geospatial Science at Cardiff University in United Kingdom. Previously, she was a research associate at Newcastle University in United Kingdom for the project, Learning from Earthquakes, Building Resilient Communities Through Earthquake Reconnaissance, Response and Recovery. She's a member of the management committee of the Earthquake Engineering Field Investigation Team and also lead the subcommittee on training. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Diana Maria now to talk about social media in emergency response and post-disaster recovery. Thank you.
No, ma'am, we can audio you.
No.
Hi, good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Okay. Then let me see. Can you see my presentation now?
No, ma'am.
No, not yet.
You have not shared the screen yet.
Okay, let me see. Share. Here. Share. So. Now.
Yes, now we can see.
Okay, thank you very much. So, thank you very much for the presentation. Thank you very much today for the invitation to survey Pakistan. Besides lecturer at Cardiff University for the Geospatial Science, and also visitor researcher at Newcastle University for the project Learning from Earthquakes, Building Resilience Community Through Response, Recovery, and Earthquake Recognition. So today I'm going to present the role of social media and crowdsourcing platforms in emergency management and post-disaster recovery assessment. This presentation will have seven parts. It's divided into seven parts, and it will include five case studies, two case studies regarding emergency response, and three case studies regarding post-disaster recovery in the long term. I would like to begin by saying that most of us check Facebook all the time, or we upload pictures to Instagram or to Flickr, or we post our opinions on Twitter. We upload or watch videos on YouTube, TikTok, or Snapchat, and even some have got recently into OnlyFans. This is what we do normally. But what happened when an earthquake or a tsunami occurred, like in Pakistan in 2019 in Kashmir? Social media platforms explode, don't they? And even some citizens have managed to report those earthquakes or the earthquake that happened in the region using crowdsourcing platforms such as LastQuake app. The question is, which kind of information these social platform and crowdsourcing platforms provide us with? We can say that the information about debris, location of damages, message of donations, images with damages in buildings, announcement of arriving and distribution of humanitarian aid, and evacuation activities. Here, for instance, we see the evacuation of newborn babies done by the supporters of the Dinamo Football Club in Zagreb. Then another question is this data useful? I will say yes, but then there will be another questions. Like how is useful, for what is useful, which data is useful, and when is useful. Then I'm going to answer these questions in the rest of the presentation. I'm going to start with when. All disaster is usually divided by several authors into four phases. In our research, we adopted the names defined by the United Nations Development Program. In this framework developed by Mary, We see the data that is necessary in all the pool disaster phases, and even the data that is necessary in the before the event. But in this research and in this presentation, we are going to focus on the data that is coming or contributed by citizens through social media and crowdsourcing platforms. After an earthquake, it's necessary to understand its impact, to respond. Then, when an earthquake happened, it's necessary to understand its impact. Recently, the social media and crowdsourcing platform have become a valuable tool to quickly collect large amount of image and text data, and in this way, generate information about the event. Then, what is the objective to use social media? The objective is to have data-driven decisions for emergency response, post disaster need assessment, to support earthquake recognizance missions, to improve post disaster recovery processes, and to improve preparedness plans for the future. In this research, we use social media for the assessment of emergency response and post disaster recovery process. To analyze the text data coming from posts on Twitter, publication on Instagram, or comment from Lastquake app, we need to use sentiment analysis and topic analysis. Why? Because this text is unstructured data, and sentiment analysis is a natural language processing technique to organize this data. This technique has been mainly used for customer review of products and places. But in this research, like hotels and restaurants. And with this technique, we determine the polarity of the text data. In this research, instead of using sentiment analysis for the review of products and places, we use it for the assessment of emergency management and post-disaster recovery. Why? Because we consider that emergency management and post-disaster recovery and services provided by governments to their citizens when they have been affected by an earthquake. Then, when an earthquake happened, the text data will have a lot of negative polarity because it will contain expression of fear, anxiety, and it will describe damages. But there will be also text data that contain information about the location of the earthquake, the epicenter, or the magnitude. That data will be classified as neutral. There will be also data related that contain message of solidarity, announcement of humanitarian aid, and messages of support. The data will be classified as positive, as we consider that will mention instance of success. Topic analysis is another natural language processing technique to automatically extract meaning from text, identifying recurrent topics and themes. Based on the dataset of the Albania earthquake in 2019, the Zagreb earthquake, and the Aegean earthquake 2020, we have identified these 12 topics. Currently, we are still working to identify those recurrent topics in the post-disaster recovery datasets, but so far we have identified these 4. Then, I'm going to start with our first case study regarding emergency response and early recovery assessment. That is the case of the Zagreb earthquake last year. This is the location of Zagreb. The earthquake of Zagreb happened the 22nd March 2020 at 5:24 in the morning with a magnitude 5.3 and a depth of 10 kilometers. One person died, 26 were injured, and 2 people more died in the cleaning operation afterwards. What is particular in this earthquake is that it was the first earthquake that happened during the lockdown imposed by European governments to stop the spread of the COVID-19. Then, when the earthquake happened, people don't know what to do. They don't know if they should stay at home despite the damages in buildings, or they should evacuate and be exposed to the virus and the low temperatures outside. In that time, it was spring in Zagreb, more or less the temperature was 4 degrees. Then, monitoring social media, such as Twitter, we identify all the hashtags related to the event. But after the first screening, we realized that we got the same tweets disregarding if they are written with capital or lowercase letter. Then we decided to keep only those hashtags with lowercase letters. We also realized that there are some hashtags that brought to general information, then we ruled them out. We also ruled out those some hashtags that we at the end eventually we realized that they were not related that they don't contain information to the Zagreb earthquake. For this research, we also need to find the translation of keywords such as earthquake to Croatian, that is potres. The final hashtag used for collecting data are in this second box. I personally start collecting data manually using these two hashtags, and this is the data that I collect. And I start to collect data following the Twitter accounts or official from the Croatian government. For instance, the Twitter account of the Prime Minister of Croatia, the Mayor of Zagreb, the representative of the World Bank for that time for Croatia, the government of Croatia, the Minister of Defense of Croatia, the Twitter account of the Municipality of Zagreb, the Twitter account of the company of public service, such as water supply, electricity, pharmacy, gas, and the Twitter account of the civil protection. So I managed to collect 212 from citizens and from public authorities. We processed the data and we plot the maps with the spatial distribution of damages in Zagreb. Then, how we plot this map? Social media platforms such as Twitter and Instagram don't have, are not georeferenced anymore due to privacy issues. Then, to be able to create a map with the spatial distribution of damages, we need to start looking at the landmarks of the city, such as the cathedral or the Society of Fine Arts in Zagreb, or look at the address on the pictures, or contact the photographers to know the coordinates of these pictures. And second, we validate the location of those pictures using the Google Street View function, which in the case of Zagreb was difficult because the pictures available in this website, in this app, were really out of date. They were from 2011. So in some cases, we still need to contact local researchers at Zagreb to validate the location of these pictures. Now, you see, we have mentioned the proxy indicator damage location, because in some cases like this one, you can see the debris, but we don't see the damage. Then we assume that the damage or the building damages should be somewhere around here. Here we can see the spatial location of the pictures portrayed by the Twitter and Instagram users that is mainly in the city center. If we make a zoom, we see again the distribution around the city center, somehow near to the epicenter. And here we can see a sample of the images, X data, provided by Twitter and Instagram users for this event. After collecting data manually, we decided to purchase Twitter data from a third-party vendor between the 20 March and the 30 April. Here we can see the peak of the tweets with the hashtag related to the earthquake in Croatia, in Zagreb. So late, we obtained this number of tweets. 33% of them were original, the rest were retweets. Later, we received this number of reports from the European Mediterranean Sismological Center. This center developed the LastWave app. Later, I'm going to explain what is this crowdsourcing platform. Then the intensity reports from LastWave app users are already georeferenced. Here you can see the intensity reports, not only for Zagreb, but from other regions in Europe when the earthquake was felt. Then we see again that the damage, the reports are concentrated in the city center of Zagreb, but also we see that some reports, we see some reports coming from the surrounding of Zagreb that we didn't see from the Twitter users. Then here we make a zoom on the city and we start to see a sample of the image and text data provided by the LastWave app users. Then, after eliminating those tweets from the 20 and 21st March before the earthquake, we came up with a reduced data set and focused on a sample of the 10%. We center our analysis on those tweets that contain image and text data. Only the 0.1 of the intensity reports from LastWave app contain image and text data at the same time. Then we extract the data, process the data, we extract the keywords using word clouds, the data using sentiment and topic analysis, following some rules, and in this word cloud you can see the phenomenon, the place where the earthquake happened, the role of the COVID, and that there was damage, the infrastructure that resulted most affected, the population group that was also most affected, and the institutions involved in the emergency response, plus additional data. Here we can see the classification of the text data into polarity. We see that the most of the data is negative because it's an earthquake, but followed by positive, neutral, and not related. Then, in this image, we can see the distribution of the polarity of data. If we make a zoom, we see the distribution of the negative, positive, and neutral data. In some places, I'm concentrated all of them. But if we see in the next map, we will see that the negative polarity map match with those buildings that were considered not usable by the University of Zagreb. So if we at least look at this one, we see, or look at this one, we see that it's not usable. Then, if we classify the text data into topics, we see that most of them will discuss about, at least for this case, discuss seismic information, building damage, emergency response, solidarity messages, injuries and casualties, lifelines affected, and intensity. Then, here we can see again the spatial distribution of the topics. Here was the epicenter of the earthquake. And here, if we make a zoom of the city, we see the location of building damages, the location of intensity reports, seismic solidarity messages, emergency response action. And we see again that the location of some building, of damages in buildings match with the red the unusability of buildings determined by the University of Zagreb in this map. Then, but to, for the assessment of the emergency response, we need to focus only on those text data that discuss the topic of emergency response. Then, looking at those tweets that only users from Twitter and Instagram discuss emergency response, not the LastQuickApp users. And we see that, again, most of the data is negative, followed by positive and neutral. In this sense, we see that the assessment of the emergency response, or at least the emergency situation, was negative, according to the citizens of Zagreb. The database with this with the classification of this data, text data, is already available for public consultation at the repository of Newcastle University. Then we enter to our second case of emergency response and early recovery. It's the case of the Aegean earthquake that happened on the 30 October 2020. This event had a magnitude of 6.9 and triggered a mini tsunami. It resulted in 119 deaths, casualties, 1,053 injured people, and at least further 15,000 homeless due to the earthquake. In this case, the main source of data was the LastQuake app. LastQuake app is a crowdsourcing platform that allows eyewitness and citizens, I mean, like you or me, to share information about the, to report earthquakes and contribute with the text and image data, but this information will be combined with seismic data. LastQuake app provide us with this number of reports after eliminating reports out of the affected area, reports that didn't have a meaning, or those that we didn't manage to translate. We use the 84% of the total database. It means 84% is this number of reports. The 95% of the reports went done using the app. The only 5% were done using the mobile phone, and at least only 1% went done. Those reports were done through the desktop computer. Here we can see that the most of the reports come from Turkey, as it was expected, also from Greece, but there were a lot of reports from a Croatian city called Zadar. Then most of the reports came from Bosnia and Herzegovina, Albania, Bulgaria, Romania, Serbia, and North Macedonia. As it is expected, most of the reports were written in Turkish. Curiously, only 4 reports were written in Greek, and some users include punctuation marks, such as exclamation or question marks. The numbers included in the report are similar to the magnitude of the earthquake, and only 3 comments we didn't manage to translate. We couldn't identify the language on which they were posted, written. Then, here we can see the spatial distribution of the image and text data provided by the LastQuake app users. Then, however, as the earthquake recognition mission of the earthquake engineering field investigation team focuses mainly on Turkey and Greece, we also focus on this area, and we observed that most of the report, the 39% of the report, indicate an intensity of 3 in the modified Mercalli intensity scale, followed by a 17% that report an intensity of 2, then 25% reported an intensity of 2, 17% reported an intensity of 4. Then 7% reported an intensity of 5, 6% reported an intensity of 1, and 5% reported an intensity of 6. Then, here is the methodology. So the data collected and submitted by LastQuake app users is stored by the EMC. They extract the data, we process the data, and we classify the data using sentiment and topic analysis, and we stored the data in the data repository of Newcastle University. And at the same time, we also plot a map based considering the result of the sentiment and topic analysis. These are the rules that we use to classify data into each polarity. And here you can see some example of text data classified as positive, negative, or neutral. And here we can see the spatial distribution of the polarity of the data. As you see, most of the negative polarity is distributed along the coast of Turkey, Greek islands, and Greek islands. Then we see that the most of the data is negative, followed by neutral, and then positive. If we look at the topic classification, here we can see the spatial distribution. As the LASCOEP app is an app to describe intensity, to report intensity, the 90% of the reports will be about that. We still find reports about building damage and tsunami effects and lifeline affected. Here you can see some example of the description of building damages in buildings by LASCOEP app users, lifeline affected, and tsunami effects. Now, if we focus on the emergency response assessment, we see that the situation is evaluated as really negative by the users and followed by far, but really far as positive. Here you can see some text with negative polarity regarding emergency response and positive polarity about the same topic. Then the data set with this classification is already available for public consultation at the repository of Newcastle University. We conclude that the user of social media and crowdsourcing platform have different profiles. That's why we, even from the same event, we got information that address different topics. Twitter and the data collected from Twitter and Instagram is useful for situation awareness, but the data provided by LASCOEP users is more useful for earthquake recognizance. Comments with negative polarity include more data about intensity, seismic information, emergency response, building damage, and tsunami effects. The spatial distribution of negative polarity is a proxy indication of the location of damages, and then injuries and casualties, and emergency response actions needed. We also observe that the text data related to emergency response is highly polarized. It's mainly negative, followed by far, but any other polarity. And we need to train citizens to contribute with more helpful data, because the cleaning of the data is really time consuming, and that makes difficult to extract meaning information. Now we move to our first case study related to post disaster recovery in the long term. The 6th April 2019, it was commemorated the 10th anniversary of the earthquake in L'Aquila. Then, the 6th April 2009, an earthquake with a magnitude 6.3 struck the Italian city of L'Aquila. The result was 308 casualties, 1,500 people injured, and at least 67,500 people homeless. 100 buildings damaged. The city center of the airport was heavily damaged. The cost of the recovery of the reconstruction was estimated in 16 billion of euros. And the The amount of waste was between 1 and 3 million of tons of waste. Then, the 6th April 2019, we purchased data using this hashtag. We obtained its number of tweets in an observation period from the 4th April to the 10th of the same month. Here we can see the activity on Twitter using the same hashtag. And here you can see some examples of tweets related to the commemoration. Here you can see the methodology that is somehow similar to the emergency response cases. We identify the hashtags related to the event. We select the hashtag that we consider that brought more information. We purchase the data, we extract the data, we process the data. In this case, we combine supervised and unsupervised classification, and we extract features using keywords. We extract features using word clouds. Then, here we can see the trend of the distribution of the polarity. At the beginning of the observation period, the data is mainly neutral, followed by then it turned negative for the next 2 days, and the exact day of the anniversary, it's the negative polarity reached their peak, then it dropped, and for the next 2 days, is mainly positive, and after that, the not related tweet surpasses all the polarities. If we see the graph of the sentiment of the final graph of the sentiment analysis, we see that the opinions about the progress of the post-disaster recovery in L'Aquila are still divided, but they are mainly negative, followed by neutral, positive, and not related. Here we can see some example of tweets with negative polarity. The keywords are highlighted and underlined, neutral and positive, and not related. The word clouds are used to extract features, so then we can know why the negative polarity on the regarding the disaster recovery process, and we see that people feel like a forgotten generation. They mentioned the city center because it was the most destroyed area. The city, the open wound, which is related to the fact that there are still rubble present on the streets, despite that more than 10 years have happened. And they still consider that what happened is a tragedy, and it still causes pain among the inhabitants of the city. They mentioned some politician, the prime minister of Italy for the time, and they consider that the reconstruction has been betrayed. Neutral polarity mainly discuss about the memorial ceremony and the prime minister of Italy for the time who attended the ceremony. And positive polarity mainly mentioned the one of the officials of the Minister of Agriculture. Yes? Can I continue with the presentation? Hi. Sorry.
Yes, please go ahead.
Okay. Okay. Then here with the word clouds with to extract words with positive polarity, we identify that the most positive polarity comes from the word reconstruction, and the Minister of Agriculture, Food and Forestry, that was planning to exploit the touristic potential of L'Aquila to boost the recovery. Another source of positive polarity is the presence of young people, because L'Aquila is the host one of the largest universities in Italy, and also the idea to explore the touristic potential of L'Aquila is that the proximity to the National Park Gran Sasso, a Monte della Laga, that is a touristic attraction. But if we look at the word cloud with the total number of words From tweets, we see that the most frequent word is reconstruction, followed by people, city, rural, and center. If we look at the most relevant term, we still go find that is they make the most relevant term as the memorial ceremony, the how people felt, a forgotten generation, the prime minister of Italy for that time, Andrea Prianti, who was the official of the Minister of Agriculture, Food and Forestry of Italy, who proposed to exploit the potential, the touristic potential of L'Aquila to boost the recovery. And that's what we can see from the word cloud. The complete data set with the sentiment analysis classification is available for public consultation at the repository of Newcastle University. Then we move to a second case of disaster recovery in the long term, that is the Maule earthquake that happened in Chile, and the anniversary was commemorated the 27th February 2020. On the 27th February 2010, an earthquake with a magnitude of 8.8 hit the coast of Chile in South America, generating also a tsunami that devastated the island of Juan Fernandez. The official death toll is 510 people and 26 people missing, but it could be more. It affected at least 1.5 million of people. Here we can see the activity on Twitter between the 15 December 2019 and the 18 April 2020. Here we can see that activity on Twitter with these hashtags peak between the 25th February and the 5th of March. We obtained this number of tweets. The 18% of them were original, the rest were retweets. Here you can see an example of one of the tweets regarding to the event. They mentioned houses that were tsunami proof somehow. And here I want to highlight the existence of a Twitter account that is specifically dedicated to remind the earthquakes in Chile, which provides a lot of useful information. Then, in this case, in the case of Chile, it happened something unusual, and is that 39%, based on a sample of the 20% of the complete data set, the 39% of the tweets were not related. Why? Because this hashtag was also used to commemorate other events in Latin America and in the world. So, but if we look to the data that is related to the event, we see that the data is mainly negative, followed by neutral and positive. However, in this case, there is something also that is not usual. People, the day of the anniversary, didn't discuss about the progress of the recovery. They complained about of the lack of a proper tsunami warning that could have saved many lives that day. Then, in this case, we need to also use the topic analysis and focus the assessment of the post-disaster recovery in those tweets that discuss recovery. Here, you can see some examples of tweets with positive, negative, neutral, and not neutral polarity and not related tweets for this case. The analysis of this case is taking additional time because most of the tweets are written in Spanish, which is the local language, and we need to translate it to English for making understandable to everyone in the world. Then, the topic analysis, then. If we focus on those tweets that discover recovery, here you can see some examples of one tweet with negative polarity and two tweets with positive polarity. I can say I observed that most of the tweets are with positive polarity regarding the case of Chile, the recovery of the after the earthquake in Chile, but they are mainly from governmental institutions. Then the data set with the classification related to this event is also available at the repository of Newcastle University, but it's only the data posted in English. Then, if we move to our last case of disaster recovery in the long term, the 12th January 2020 was the 10th anniversary of the earthquake in Haiti. Unfortunately, there have been a lot of earthquakes recently in this poor country. The 12th January 2010, and more or less 4 in the afternoon, an earthquake with a magnitude of 7 devastated the capital of Haiti, Port-au-Prince. At least 316,000 people died, and the reconstruction of the country was estimated to be around $7.8 billion. Here we can see the example, one of the images of the cathedral in Haiti. We collected data about this anniversary between the 6th January and the 15th of the same month, in 2020. We see how the activity on Twitter peaked between the 12th of January and peak on the 12th of January and then fall steadily for the next coming days. Using this hashtag, we obtained this number of tweets. The 17% of them were original, the rest are retweets. And here we can see one example of one of the tweets related to the anniversary of the earthquake in Haiti. Then, in this case, we didn't use a supervised classification. We trained an algorithm using the 1% of the total data, or at least the data that it was already written in English. And we observed that the most of the data using a sample of 11% of the data, we see that the assessment of the post-disaster recovery process of the earthquake in Haiti is highly negative, followed by positive, not related, and neutral. And here we can see one example of the tweets with negative polarity. We need to remember that this country was hit not only by the earthquake, but also for the cholera epidemic that was brought for the, unfortunately, by the teams of the United Nations that supported the recovery. Then we can conclude that the tweets regarding the memorial are not necessarily trending topics like the events itself, like the earthquakes. Well, the anniversary of the earthquake in L'Aquila was trending topic, at least in Europe. That could be a reason, could be the geographic location. However, the critical day to collect the data is the exact day of the anniversary. Tweets from citizens contain more data and more reliable data than the tweets from the institution, because of course government will tend to say that everything's going fine. And we found that the sentiment analysis is a suitable method for disaster recovery assessment. The predefined model of sentiment analysis, we then discuss accuracy, but at least when we try for our cases, the predefined models have an accuracy of 53%, but the customized model that we try for the classification of the data of the Haiti earthquake have a higher accuracy. Then, just to finish, the recommendations. When an earthquake or a tsunami strike your country, please, first, keep you safe, protect yourself, evacuate, consider vertical evacuation in the case of a tsunami, report that you are safe using, for instance, the function from Facebook, and please, once you are safe, take pictures from structural damages in structural elements and not structural elements, not only from buildings but also from infrastructure and also from like roads or schools, And please upload pictures to any social media platform such as Twitter, Instagram, Flickr, on Facebook, or please download and install the Lastway app. And I also recommend you to contribute with search and rescue activities, reporting people who can be trapped, including the address or some clue for the location. Because as I said before, social media platforms such as Twitter are not georeferenced. I took these tweets from the data set of the tweets from Turkey. And in this case, the user indicates the location of the people who can be trapped. I also ask you to download or install the Earthquake Network and the MyCheck app on your mobile phones to contribute to the detection of earthquakes and receive early warnings. Then, finally, I will ask you to follow the project Learning from Earthquakes on Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, and Facebook. And feel free also to follow me also in these social media platforms. These are the main references used for this research. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Diana, for this comprehensive presentation.
Thank you.
Now we have some questions in the chat section.
Yes.
Can you please see?
Yes, yes, yes. Let me see. Welcome.
The first question is from Roya.
Yes. Yes, all of them looks very good question. The idea, and I forgot to include to mention that if we need to train citizens to provide useful information, what is useful information? Location of damages, location of injured people, where the emergency actions are needed. Yes. People tend to send solidarity messages, which are, of course, are appreciated. But in the case of an emergency, it's necessary to indicate more practical things to support emergency institution to know where they should deploy a staff. This is one of the aspects of a project that I want to formulate, that is how to train citizens to contribute with useful information for emergency response. The second question is the social media information is proper. Firstly, there is similarity between. Okay, the question is there a similarity between the periodic character of the pattern in disaster and other event? I'm not sure if I understand the question. A similarity between the periodic character of the pattern in disaster and other event? Well, I won't say. I cannot say between the disaster, but what we are trying to find in this research is patterns in the data collected during emergency response and during post-disaster recovery. And we have already identified recurrent topics during emergency response, and I say we are identifying recurrent topics during the anniversaries of the earthquakes. The second question from Abdulkit, is the distribution of social media density overlapped with the most hazardous places? No, unfortunately. Well, there are, for instance, in order that a crowdsourcing platform like Earthquake Network or MyShake app works, they need to have enough users to be able that the mobile phones detect the earthquake and also can send an early warning. So sometimes it's true. It's the distribution of social media doesn't overlap the most hazardous places. But the idea is that social media can somehow in the future overlap these places and we can obtain more information from citizens located in places affected by earthquakes or any other kind of disasters. The question from Asmat is, can you please elaborate what actually are neutral results and their significance? Yes, well, neutral results are are this data that discuss about in the case of emergency response is more data related to the characteristic of the event. For instance, the data that indicate the magnitude, the epicenter of the event or the location is neutral data. Yeah, it doesn't indicate if the situation is getting worse or better. Yes, and in the case of a disaster recovery, it's more related to the memorial ceremonies. Because the memorial ceremonies indicate that there is a commemoration of the anniversary, but it doesn't keep tell us if the process is going well or the progress of the reconstruction is delayed. That's why it's considered neutral date. The question from Roya is, well, okay, thank you very much for the presentation and for the answer. Yes, I think I finished with the questions in the chat. I'm not sure if there is another question from the audience.